Recorded Books and RB Digital present We Didn't Ask for This by Adi Alsaid, narrated by Maria Liatis. To the Greta Thunbergs, Isra Hirsis, Schutzkatl Martinez's, and Autumn Peltiers of the world. Part 1. Lock and Night. 1. 7:35 p.m. The lock-in was going fairly well until Marisa unleashed her cronies and chained herself to the main entrance. No one really noticed right away, busy as they were taking part in a number of lock-in-related activities. Laser tag in the parking garage, a sanctioned food fight in the cafeteria, a photoshoot tutorial with a renowned YouTube influencer. Once a year, in April, the doors at Central International School's K-12 campus closed, though they didn't literally lock, to allow the high school students to roam free for the whole night. Having the next day off school was nowhere near the best part. Nor, strictly speaking, were the activities themselves, though they were extravagant and wonderful and distracted everyone from what Marisa was doing. People fell in love on lock-in night. They stumbled upon new passions that would shape the rest of their lives, discovered friendships they could not imagine living without, before or after. Traumas were resolved on lock-in night. Anxieties disappeared, never to return, not even after the buses arrived in the morning to take the students back home. This was well known to the few students who had been lucky enough to have attended before, or who had siblings who had attended in years prior. At Central International School, the student body ebbed and flowed, changing drastically from year to year, and often even more frequently. It was common to have different classmates every semester, and sometimes students would find the person who sat next to them in class, the alluring redhead who scribbled song lyrics on the margins of their textbooks, who one time turned and asked to borrow a pen they never returned, though they had offered a smile that carried with it joy beyond a simple gesture, the redhead who might have one day soon become more than just a classmate, was simply gone from one day to the next. Even by international school standards, the turnover rate of both students and faculty had always been high. Though it had a great academic reputation, and the city in which it sat was a diverse and world-class cosmopolis. Yet people never seemed to stick around for long, as if families were carried in by the seaside breeze and carried away by the same. Most students had multiple passports, and their parents were multinational or transient because they were diplomats, or titans of industry, or missionaries, or digital nomads, or teachers within the international school world. They had roots in many places, thought of no one place as home, or rather, thought of everywhere they'd been as home. So it was rare for a student to be around for several lock-in nights. Even the locals, who made up a mere 15% of the school's population, often temporarily relocated during their high school years. A boarding school exchange in Switzerland, a South American road trip in a van with their family, a missionary excursion in Central America. Despite all this, the lore surrounding lock-in night was always momentous, starting as an excited murmur the first day of school and building to a frenzy by the night before the event itself a month or so before the end of the year. Students wondered how, exactly, their life would be improved by the evening. There was no question it would. They could feel it on their skin. Their heartbeats thudded with the knowledge that things were about to change. They had absorbed the gossip, not just a rumor or two, but dozens and dozens of firsthand accounts or verifiable secondhand stories, so many of them that it did not feel like hearsay, but like fact. It was the how that was exciting. Would the red-headed classmate return to slip a hand into theirs during the movie marathon on the roof garden? Would their fear of heights be cured by the trapeze the school had set up on the football field? Or would it simply be a night of such fun that the joy would sink into their bones and change them into happier people? Lock-in night, simply put, was magic. Even all those who had never experienced it knew it to be true. Which, of course, was why Marisa planned her protest for that well-loved night. To make people pay attention, disrupt what brings them joy. The mad desire to act had existed long before her plan did. Marisa loved the water as a baby, Her parents told the stories to anyone who would listen. She always feigned embarrassment at their anecdotes about her hour-long baths and surprising performance in toddler swimming classes, her dark curly hair unfurling in the water behind her like a mermaid, her brown eyes huge within the goggles she always carried around. But the truth was that she loved the stories. They confirmed this was not a passing fad, not a childhood obsession that would lose its significance over time, not a baby blanket carried around charmingly until age 10 when it was shoved into a box and donated. When she discovered snorkeling and later diving, that love blew wide open. This had been possible this whole time? Though Marisa was only 17, her parents' constant relocations for work meant she'd seen a hefty percentage of the world's waters. She'd snorkeled in Mexico, Fiji, the Philippines, the Great Barrier Reef, Belize. And the more she did it, the more her heart broke. Human beings had found a way to kill water. The places famed for their snorkeling were heart-wrenching. The destroyed beige reefs littered the oceans like ornate gravestones. They should have been resplendent with color. Books and scientists told her as much, and other divers did too. Of course, though, they weren't. Not anymore. The world had ruined that particular beauty before Marisa had ever had a chance to see it, killing the corals with spilled chemicals, suffocating the oceans with heat. Every time she surfaced, she would dive into the internet, trying to find a way to help, changing her sunscreen to the reef-safe kind, cleaning up plastic on the beach, asking her parents to donate yet again. Nothing felt big enough. Then came the 3-day weekend at the start of the school year that changed it all. She had convinced her parents to take the family to the beach, and the Cuevases, who knew their frequent moves could be hard on the children, relented despite the fact that neither of them felt settled in at work yet, and they would have really liked to stay in the city and run errands. Marisa had heard amazing things about the snorkeling in the region surrounding the beach. She was always skeptical when she heard anything like that. She'd been disappointed enough. She was fine just swimming among whatever fish remained in the area and pretending this was what it had always been like. This was the wondrous alien world other divers described. After their most recent move, she'd done her usual research and found on the most trustworthy sources that an untouched blip still existed, not too far from her new school. She convinced her parents, who knew it was better to indulge Marisa than fight her, to take a boat to an island, then another, smaller boat to another smaller island. Arriving at the clear turquoise waters, which were peppered with butterflies from who knows where fluttering across the surface, whole waves of them outnumbering the tourists she had seen even on the mainland, Marisa allowed herself to hope. Well before her family was ready, Marisa was in her flippers and mask, and she sat on the edge of the boat and let herself fall backward into the warm waters. At first, her heart had soared. Greens, purples, oranges, bright colors in the reefs, finally. The schools of fish were more like armies, numbered not in dozens, but in hundreds, maybe even thousands. Various species all swimming in their separate schools, like great big flags unfurling mightily in the water. Marisa followed them, kicking delightedly, her heart flooding with joy. Then she turned a corner around some rocks, and her breath caught, as if someone had reached inside her chest and closed a massive fist around her lungs. Even here, she found murk and drudgery. The reef not on display so much as its dying was. She emerged from the water and took off her mask, tears mixing with the waves. People and the trash with which they suffocated the world. She looked around, shading her eyes from the shimmering sunlight with her free hand. Maybe it was time to accept the world as it was. As she turned to swim back to shore, she caught sight of something on the far end of the island. A construction site. Large, acres and acres of it, from what Marisa could tell, and a handful of bulldozers. She swam closer and saw the sign announcing the coming resort. Nearby, a trickle of brown-gray water weaved its way from below the makeshift wall around the site and dribbled onto the sand. Yes, it was a travesty, an outrage that the world had been ruined before her arrival. But that trickle hadn't reached all the way to the shore, not yet. As soon as she and her family made it back to their eco-hotel that day, Marisa decided she had to stop that waste from reaching the ocean. Whatever she could do for the reefs, she was going to do it. If it was just shutting down that one construction site, or if it was something much bigger, she had to try. What else was there but to try? Months of stewing later, of planning, of seeing the ruined remains of the ocean floors every time she closed her eyes, of thinking of a way to make everyone else see what she saw, it all led up to this moment when Marisa hoisted a chain from the duffel bag she'd hidden on campus a few days ago. She weaved it through the handles on the double doors that led into the main school building. Then she wrapped it three times around her own body, uncomfortably tight, so bolt cutters could not break through the metal without snagging on her skin. When she was satisfied, she grabbed three giant padlocks from the bag and locked herself in, meaning to stay. She set the keys in the middle of her palm, rubbing them each in a pat of butter procured earlier from the cafeteria, and which had warmed nicely in her pocket throughout the afternoon. Then Marisa, rehearsing her speech in her mind one last time, looked up. She expected to see a sizable crowd already gathering. What she saw instead was a lanky blonde sophomore leaving the bathroom across the open expanse of the building's foyer. The boy was checking to see if he'd remembered to zip up. He had not. When his eyes met Marissa's, he could tell she had seen him checking, and he stepped quickly away from her line of sight, failing to notice the heavy metal chain wrapped around her torso. This boy was on his way to the gymnasium, where Amira Wahid was waiting for the whistle that would signify the start of the CIS Intrasport Decathlon. The year before, arriving from a school in Colombia only weeks prior to the lock-in, Amira had won the girls' category, which annoyingly came with the qualifier of best female athlete. This year, Amira had enrolled in the boys' decathlon, not bothering to check if it was allowed, wanting it to be known that she was, at least in this one aspect, or rather these 10 aspects, better than all. Basketball, running, rock climbing, it didn't matter. She could beat anyone. For once, she did not want her gender to qualify her. There was some resistance, but in the end, the parents and board members at CIS were a little more liberal than not, and the fight was dropped. Already inspired by Amira, several girls crossed the gender distinction, and some boys, in what they believed was a show of solidarity, signed up for the girls' competition. In the end, the lists were too hard to distinguish, and the gender distinctions were dropped altogether. Amira, for her part, didn't pay much attention to the controversies or general conversation. She was too busy training, sweating, repeating the same motions over and over again until they became as ingrained and natural and unconscious as breathing. Some of her exercises, Amira came to believe, even took on the rhythm of her heart. The jab-hook combo against the punching bag. Thunk-thunk. The two dribbles she needed on a basketball court to take the ball from the top of the three-point line to the rim. Thunk-thunk. Her feet on the track, on asphalt, on grass. Thunk-thunk. She loved how the world felt while she trained, loved that it all seemed designed for her enjoyment. The air and the sun and the ground beneath her feet. She loved the strain of her body, how she could feel it getting stronger, more limber, how she could get better at controlling its movement day by day by day. More than anything, Amira loved to surprise people, to anger them, confound them with the things she could do with her body. The look on boys' faces when she was stronger, faster, better. The look on those boys' dads' faces, the look on her coaches' faces, when she outshone them all. Amira's mother was not aware of any of this. Not the training, not the decathlon, and certainly not the anger. Amira was a different girl in front of her mother, at home in general, than she was at CIS. This wasn't out of necessity. At least, Amira didn't think so. Her mother was strong-willed, sure, but Amira had never tested that well. If she pushed back against her mother's beliefs about what Amira could not or should not do, about what girls could not or should not do, her mother might very well respect her wishes. Her dad, certainly, was less of a traditionalist than many Malaysian men of his generation. Amira became someone else at school merely out of opportunity. At home, there were expectations pressing down on her. Not forcefully, but they weighed heavily just the same. Expectations of what a girl should do and be. Expectations of religion. Expectations of family. Expectations of sexuality. Expectations that she did not feel equipped to go against. And though she did not hold herself to many of these expectations, her parents did. And that wasn't something she could ignore. Amira did not know how her parents would react if she outwardly bucked any of these expectations, and so she tried as best as she could to fit within them. She was never forced to act a certain way. The expectations were so heavy that she didn't dare subvert them. At school, though, the expectations felt easily shed. They were not religious or familial. They weren't ingrained into the history of who she was. The expectations outside of her home felt, at worst, superficial. Society and its expectations, albeit plentiful and obsequious, were not tethered to Amira's soul. So she could leave them behind, chasing the thunk-thunk of her heart instead. Most people expected Amira to win, though a handful of others believed Omar Ng's strength and speed were superior simply because of his masculinity. Omar, for his part, standing on the opposite side of the gymnasium from Amira, likewise awaiting the first event, a one-on-one basketball tournament, wished Amira the best, and at least partially hoped she would beat him. He wanted only to do his best, or whatever amount of athleticism might impress PJ Singh. Omar eyed the bleachers, looking for PJ's magnificent face in the stands. Those dark eyes of his, that unblemished brown skin, the softness of which would be apparent even from across the gym. There were plenty of people, many holding up poster board signs in support of Amira and a handful for Omar, with a few more scattered signs for other competitors unlikely to succeed against the two frontrunners. Others had signs advertising their team or club's event or booth at the lock-in. Some held signs simply in support of lock-in night itself. Omar couldn't see PJ there, but right before the whistle sounded, he thought he saw his younger sister, Joy, fiddling near the exit to the gymnasium, holding something shiny. While her brother checked the ball to his opponent, Joy Ang tried to remember Marissa's exact instructions. Loop twice, then over and through, or over and through, then loop twice? She'd lost the notebook paper where she'd written it down. Joy didn't want to disappoint Marissa by messing up the chains and not having everyone properly locked in. She pushed her glasses farther up the bridge of her nose and fixed her hair back up into its usual messy bun, figuring it would be enough to simply make the metallic knot as convoluted as possible. The steel clinked satisfyingly in her hands, and she smiled as the gym burst into cheers around her. Amira had scored her first basket of the tournament, a beautiful pull-up jumper from the elbow. Joy felt like she was making Marissa proud, but right at the moment she clicked the locks into place, she realized she had forgotten to use the bathroom. Longingly, she looked across the gym, where at that moment Celeste Rollins emerged from one of the two unisex toilets. Unlike most everyone else, Celeste was not enjoying lock-in night. A new student at CAS, Celeste had never lived outside of the U.S. before, and had struggled to make friends. Struggled is too generous a word. Celeste had failed to make friends for the past 8 months. No one was mean to her, nor did they hold her Americanness against her, but no one made a space for her either. She could at least partially understand. It was what she came to think of as her unfortunate singlehood. Single passport, single language, single previous home. All these other kids knew the world up close, knew its histories and beautiful nooks, knew the nuances between regional versions of Spanish, could name the king of Thailand. Celeste had not known Thailand was a kingdom. She had seen the world only in textbooks and on TV, in news segments that whittled down foreign countries to the dangers they presented. Even the other American kids at CIS were more worldly than Celeste. They had bounced from embassy to embassy, continent to continent, as their parents were transferred or sought to be missionaries or chased their whims. And while these kids wore American sports jerseys to school and hung around together, speaking only in English, they knew how to wield the local slang, how to maneuver the metro system, where to go on weekends, how to live abroad. They didn't remember what life in the States was like, if they had ever been there at all. They lived in walled-off country clubs or came to school in a van straight from the Mormon church. Even the two other Black American kids, Casey and Jay Robinson, originally from New York, offered no easy welcome, though they were instinctively the first people she would have sought out, had they not been elementary students. Whenever Celeste had tried to squeeze herself into a group of Americans, at lunch while they sat by the soccer field bleachers, in the chatty minutes before the remedial classes meant to teach them the local language, though many of these students followed their parents' leads and barely bothered to attempt learning, there had seemed to be no room for her. They were drawn to each other's Americanness, not hers. Whether it was racism or a lack of shared experiences and upbringing, it did not ease the pain of loneliness. Celeste loved people. She loved their company, at least when she'd had it in Glen Ellen. She loved their mannerisms, loved their voices and their laughs, loved when her former babysitter Aaron came by unannounced just to see her, or when her friend Jamie texted every morning, even though they always met in front of the park district pool, where almost everyone they knew, including the two of them, had spent at least one summer lifeguarding or working the snack bar, to walk to school together. And she loved, more than anything, her place among all these people. With the younger kids from the suburban neighborhood, she was the girl with the trampoline, whose parents let them come by whenever they wanted to. In swim class, she was not the fastest or the slowest, but the one who knew everyone's name and stayed up late with her mom the night before meets baking cookies. She was the Colsons' babysitter, Jamie's best friend, Mrs. Silver's newest and briefest employee at the kitchen supply store on Main Street. She was Celeste Rollins of Forest Street in Glen Ellen, Illinois, a student of Glen Bard West High School. Go Hilltoppers! She was one of the few Black students there, yes, and that had come with its share of microaggressions and difficulties, but it had been home. Glen Ellen was all Celeste had ever known, but when her parents decided to leave the U.S., she allowed herself to grieve only until the flight to her new home. Yes, she would miss all these people. The way they fit into her life in the most comfortable of ways, like a play she knew by heart. Not just her lines, but everyone else's too. But there would be a new play for her to step into, a new, rich cast of characters, and she would learn her lines quickly. She was sure of it. That wasn't how it had happened. Celeste thought she'd been prepared for the language barrier, but she definitely had not. After 6 months, her brain was still struggling to retain words because her mouth had not yet managed to grasp onto the different sounds it had to make. Sounds it had never attempted before. Vowels? Who knew they could elude her? An I was not an I here. That wasn't all. The toilets were different. The times people ate. Celeste had no idea these things could vary among nations. Noon was lunchtime. She thought that had been universal. Still, she had been hopeful that when she met the kids of CIS, she would find her place among them. Her first day of school, she woke up well before her alarm rang. She texted Jamie for support, but across the world, Jamie was at after-school soccer practice. Or was she sleeping? It was hard to do the math of time zones. Celeste practiced what she would say while she showered, while she brushed her teeth, while she had her usual Glen Ellen breakfast of oatmeal and a banana. The oatmeal would have to be rationed out. Her favorite brand was nowhere to be found. She did her hair up in a pineapple pony, and it had cooperated beautifully, the curls and her bangs perfectly springy. And when the nice, air-conditioned city bus that served as a school bus came to pick her up, she put on a smile and tried to make eye contact with the people already seated. They had earphones in, or were dozing with their heads against the glass. Two black girls sat and spoke with each other, their hair in admirable, intricate braids that gave her an in to comment on. But they did not look up when Celeste approached. Toward the back, there was a tall, curly-haired boy in a hoodie reading a book. Celeste smiled at him, and he looked away immediately, shy and skittish. She thought, "Ah, I know my lines here." Repeating her practice lines under her breath one last time, she stood just in front of the boy and waited for him to look back up. Then the bus jolted forward and caused her to stumble into an empty seat behind him. After that, it felt too awkward to move back to him. She waited for someone to take a seat next to her, but apparently she was one of the last stops and the seat remained empty. When she finally tried the local language on someone outside of her homeroom class, they laughed and said, "Dude, we all speak English here." At lunch that day, she finally found a group of Americans to sit with, but they didn't speak about the same things she would have spoken about with anyone in Glen Ellen. A summer of partying on boats off the Croatian coast, of family yoga retreats in Bali, of junior internships with leading tech companies in San Francisco, instead of a summer of biking the streets, of boredom and pools and barbecues, of road trips to Wisconsin. Her lines did not fit into this play. The misfires continued, and with each one, a terrifying realization dawned on Celeste. She was not at home anymore. So of course Celeste had looked forward to the lock-in night. When the posters started coming up, she saw an opportunity. She'd signed up for everything that had a sign-up sheet. The ceramics club workshop, the game of tag to raise awareness about housing inequality, the hot sauce club Spice Scream Social. But for the first 2 hours of the lock-in, her aspirations of meeting someone to connect with, of finding even a glimpse of a home at CIS, had not come to fruition. She had sampled 3 hot sauces before leaving that particular room, finding it hard to interrupt the little groups of 3s and 4s. She had participated in the lock-in night escape room. The students who'd organized it were thrilled to hear, once the news broke, what Marisa had done. But since she hadn't arrived with a group, she had been assigned to a quartet of resentful seniors. They had barely looked at her the entire time, speaking in a mix of languages Celeste couldn't even identify. Now she stood outside the bathroom in the gym wondering where to go next, feeling the enormous weight of unmet expectations pressing down on her diaphragm. Everywhere, people walked and gathered and laughed in groups. Celeste felt as if there were a spotlight on every single one of them, and only she remained in the shadows. Then she noticed another poster. More of a paper, really, obviously ripped from a notebook not long before and taped up on this spot last minute. The font unimpressive and sloppy, unlike the majority of lock-in posters. Wanna laugh? Improv. Funny. Fun. 8 p.m., the room behind the theater. An arrow pointed the way, so Celeste, encouraged by its goofiness, having been raised in a family that constantly poked fun at each other, headed toward Kenji Pierce, looking for the comforts of a laugh. Kenji Pierce was at that moment standing outside the room trying to coax various passerby to come in and watch his improv team perform. Not many had heeded his call, save for a group of impressionable freshmen who had heard Ludovico Rigo was on the team and were happy to have the opportunity to watch him do anything for 15 straight minutes. To watch him and giggle and to be expected to do nothing else. A luxury, a dream come true. Lock-in night truly was sublime. Among all the students at CIS looking forward to the lock-in, everyone who had lain awake at night picturing the fun that was to be had, everyone who drifted off in class daydreaming, the excitement they felt deep down in their bellies as soon as they learned of the night, and which had been rising to the surface as the date inched closer, none were happier right at that moment than tall, lanky, bespectacled Kenji Pierce, whose hair was eternally cowlicked, and his smile, it seemed, smeared across his face just as consistently. Kenji, a freshman who had been at CIS a remarkable 3 years and had been looking forward to his first year of high school so he could finally take part in the lock-in, had admittedly not done much in the way of activity so far. He'd half listened to the welcoming ceremony, which had featured a celebrity alum Kenji did not recognize, choosing instead to spend that time cracking jokes with his best friend, Lindsay. As soon as they were dismissed and the fun began, Kenji and Lindsay ran off toward the food trucks parked by the soccer field. He'd order a trio of Southeast Asian tacos to go. Had he known how long it would be before he was allowed outside again, he might still have chosen to do what he did next, which was to run across the field toward the back staircase and go immediately to sit in the green room. The green room was the classroom behind the theater, used normally for drama and cinematography classes, as well as the occasional spillover English class. There was no need for Kenji and Lindsay to be there that early. The improv showcase wasn't set to start for another 2 hours, and all the other members of their team were playing laser tag in the parking garage. But Kenji was ready for improv, and he was happy to wait with Lindsay and ignore all other activities until it came. They sat and joked and played some warm-up games, and when Lindsay said she wanted to go check out the food fight for a minute, Kenji stood in the hallway trying to get people to fill the theater. It would fill up. Every event at lock-in night seemed to get a far better turnout than even the most hopeful organizers had wished for. There were dozens of events going on at the same time, and a limited number of people with which to fill those activities, but no club was ever disappointed. Kenji cared little for the crowd size. He just cared that he could play improv in front of others, that he could profess his love for it, that he could do it free of judgment. He spent all his time with improv, made any homework assignment he could about the subject, no matter how tangentially, and the people at school would ask only, "Yes, and?" His classmates seemed to inherently understand that central tenet of improv, to accept the terms presented to you and build upon them. His father, on the other hand, would say it was impractical to build something without first tearing down what was there before. Arthur Pierce worked in construction, and he was constantly making comments like that, which didn't entirely make sense, but rather seemed aimed to prove that Kenji was wrong. At home, Kenji had heard no a lot from his father. No, a Pierce could not opt out of a sport. No, a Pierce could not play pranks on the whole family. No, a Pierce could not play pranks on just the British side, nor on just the Japanese side, nor on just the Spanish cousin who had married in last summer. No, a shadow puppet show wasn't an appropriate post-dinner activity at the restaurant. No, they couldn't listen to a podcast in the car. No, humor wasn't particularly important, was not to be given the weight of responsibilities, of school courses, of ambition, of concrete. No, humor could not be, in itself, an ambition. But this place had so few restrictions, so few parameters built around what a person could be. The audience saw a Japanese boy with a British accent and a goofy sense of humor and thought, as if they had each been trained in the art of improv, "Yes, and." They saw someone like Omar Eng, a valedictorian and a star athlete, all while being shy and awkward, and they thought, "Yes, and?" For his classmates and teachers, a person's characteristics were not boxes, or rather buildings, to place them into. They were colors with which to paint a whole unique picture. Now, with the minutes until the showcase ticking away, Kenji watched his fellow CISers go see cucumbers, and felt a deep appreciation for every single one of them. The ones who hadn't heard him as they passed, and the ones who absolutely had heard him but didn't pay attention alike. Those few who trickled in with full intent to watch the showcase, as well as those who passed by in groups, who heard Kenji enthusiastically beckoning them inside, looked at one another with a shrug, then went to take a seat. Kenji loved every single one of them. Here was Ludovico, fellow improv lover, who walked through the hallways not as if he had hordes of underclassmen gawking at him, but as if he was still exploring the tiny Sumatran island he'd spent 6 years growing up on. Ludo moved barefoot through the school, a beatific smile always on his face, like a handsome blonde yogi blessing everyone in his path. And here was PJ Singh, speedwalking through the hallway past Kenji, headed toward the back staircase near the green room. His friend Diego Cuevas had just texted saying the door was locked, which it definitely should not have been. The back staircase was one of the keys to PJ's whole plan. It, along with the basement, was the entryway for the booze, the hundreds of earphones, the DJ equipment, the DJ himself. For decades, the CIS lock-in night had traditionally come with a clandestine party organized by a single student. Each year, the previous year's partier-in-chief would pick out the one person they believed could best carry on the tradition with both secrecy and flair. If the transient nature of CIS's student body proved this impossible, it was put to a school-wide vote. That had been the case this year, and PJ Singh had won overwhelmingly versus fellow senior Jordi Marcos. Every student knew about the party, and everyone was invited, though many chose not to go, either because they were busy or too frightened of the possibility of getting caught. This, despite the fact that no lock-in party had ever been discovered, and no single student had ever faced consequences or questioning related to their nefarious absence. Oh, the faculty had heard rumblings, of course, and each year the teachers bet money on whether the party would be discovered, and by whom, and in which room, like a CIS-specific game of Clue. Usually, the gambling ring itself would be discovered, and the organizing staff member was always the only one to face ramifications. Higher-ups in the administration didn't condone the partying and wanted teacher efforts to focus on keeping the students from harming themselves and the school's reputation, not on profiting off illicit activities. Regardless, PJ didn't want to risk being the first host to get caught, though he did want to be remembered. In fact, PJ wanted to throw a party so great that every single CISer attended. He wanted even the teachers to attend, without them knowing it. He wanted the party to set the standard for future hosts, wanted it to be all people could talk about once the night was done. He looked forward to the winks and high fives he would get at 6 a.m. when the doors opened and the buses and parents arrived to take the kids back home for the day. He fantasized about the text messages that would flood his phone throughout the weekend, if not the rest of the year. Maybe the rest of his life? PJ sometimes let these fantasies get carried away, imagining a time 20 years or so from the night when he would be contacted by people like Zaira Jacobson or Amar Eng, people who would clearly go on to live not just good lives, but impressive ones, remarkable lives full of remarkable parties. "My partying days are coming to an end, and yours top them all," they would say. And PJ would look back on his days of partying and be hard-pressed to find a night that compared to this one. PJ had been waiting 3 years for his opportunity to host, ever since he was a freshman and his brother, Hamish, had been the partier-in-chief. That year, Hamish had somehow managed to throw the party underwater. He never revealed how he did it, not even to PJ, but by the day of the party, a secret room had appeared beneath the koi pond at the campus's main entrance. It must have been under cover of night and involved some hefty bribes to the school's security guards, with dozens of workers needed to finish it all up from one school day to the next. The large rocks beside the pond had been replaced with fake ones that could be easily moved and which served to hide the trap door, which led into the room that allowed about 20 students at a time to party, and which those who knew about it still occasionally used to skip class and smoke cigarettes. The ceiling of the room, somehow, was the glass bottom of the pond itself, and the night of that party, the moon had been full, and the light refracted through the water, making the room softly shimmer, like something out of a dream. PJ had already been in awe of his brother, and he had ignored all other lock-in activities to stay at Hamish's side all night. He hadn't known someone could be so universally adored. The joy that had lit up people's faces when they came down the stairs and found the secret room, the booze and the music and the couch behind a curtain for couples to make out on. It had been a masterful party, no doubt, but by nature of the room's size, too exclusive. Hamish had said so himself, regretting the fact that no one wanted to leave the secret room to make space for others to experience the party, and because of that, not everyone had been able to attend. PJ had been dreaming of his chance to host well before Hamish's accident a week earlier, which had turned PJ's brother into a ragdoll lying in a hospital bed. His nights accompanied by the fitful snoring of people who loved him, sleeping uncomfortably at his side, by the gentle whir of machinery keeping him alive, the occasional squeak of a nurse's comfortable white sneakers going past in the hall, the rhythmic beeps of monitors. PJ had considered skipping the party and staying at his brother's side. but it had been 4 straight days of just that, and PJ's parents insisted that he take a break, distract himself. Hamish, too, likely would have agreed. And after all the planning he'd done, much of it with Hamish in mind, it would have been a waste not to attend the lock-in. This way, he'd be able to give Hamish a story when he woke up. A locked door would not come between PJ and this dream to throw a party that would honor what Hamish had done 3 years ago, and maybe even rise above it. A party Hamish would be proud of. He expected this door thing to be no big deal. Diego, bless his pretty little heart, was a kind and beautiful boy who often had problems with doors. It's not that PJ thought Diego was dumb. Diego was Marisa Cuevas' brother, so on genes alone, it was unlikely that he'd come out completely inept. But Diego's intelligence was not rooted in mechanical things. However, what PJ found was no small mechanical issue. It was sophomore Malik Harris, who played on the school's rugby team and was not small at all. Malik, for some reason, had a heavy steel chain wrapped around his torso and through the double doors leading out to PJ's staircase. 3 large padlocks hung off the chains, and though PJ, rightly, guessed 2 of them were purely ornamental, it still gave the impression that Malik meant to stay put for a long while. Even more troublesome, next to Malik was a 5-liter jug of water, something wrapped in tinfoil, presumably a sandwich, 2 books, assorted snacks, an electronic tablet, a phone charger, and a bucket. Surrounding Malik and staring down at him were a gaggle of freshmen, that American girl from PJ's art class, Ludovico Rigo, swoon, and the improv team's mentor and notoriously lenient English teacher, Mr. Giggs. There were many questions swimming around in PJ's mind, and he didn't know why, out of all the things he wanted to ask, he chose the one question he already knew the answer to. Malik, what is that bucket for? Two. 7:55 p.m. The crowds finally gathered at 4 of the 5 main exits of the school building. It was not so much that they had noticed the people chained to the doors or had a sense that they meant to disrupt the evening, but rather that they had places they wanted to go to, activities to participate in, friends to meet. Marisa watched their faces as they approached, watched as they suddenly understood their joy was facing an obstacle. Good, she thought. When she felt the tug behind her of someone trying to make their way in, she knew it was time. She reached into her duffel bag and pulled out the megaphone. Most people in the crowd assumed it was a shtick, performance art of some sort. It wasn't unusual for one of the artsy kids to stage their magnum opus this way. The teachers, especially, assumed it was just one of those lock-in night things. Marisa fired off a quick text to her cronies. Deliver the speech. She turned on the megaphone, a sharp whine of feedback making everyone cringe. Marisa cleared her throat. Attention students and faculty of CIS.
Go see cucumbers,
someone shouted from the back. The people who couldn't yet tell this was going to ruin their night laughed. Marisa continued. We are all murderers, or at the very least, accomplices to the atrocities committed to our oceans and our reefs. Someone groaned. The faculty gave each other looks, trying to suss out what exactly was happening and what their responsibilities were. At 3 of the 4 other exits, Marissa's cronies read the same speech she had memorized. Until this school and its community members commit to take the following steps toward rescuing the reefs from the brink of extinction, especially the ones in our backyard, everyone within this building will remain inside. Now that it had been spelled out for them, a murmur started growing in the foyer of the high school building. Marisa continued to enumerate her 30 demands. Single-use plastic was to be immediately banned at CIS. Everyone present would sign a petition to ban it worldwide, and all CIS family members would be encouraged to sign as well. All diesel boats were to switch to biodiesel. A radius of 50 meters around any coral reef was to be designated a marine protected area. Construction of the planned resort on Loco Loco Island was to be canceled. I'm sorry, did you just say diesel boats? PJ Singh asked Malik, who had just reached that part of the speech on the electronic tablet from which he was reading. Malik said. Marisa had told them to ignore any hecklers or interruptions, but she had never said anything about how to handle PJ. And here was PJ Singh asking Malik a direct question about the list of demands. Malik said again, and his eyes flicked back down to the screen, trying to find his place. But PJ snapped his fingers and said, "Don't keep reading. Are you holding this door hostage over diesel goddamn boats?" Malik started to say no, then explained that it was much more than just boats. And on that note, it wasn't just this door. It was every way in and out of the main building. He explained that they were following Marisa Cuevas' lead in order to enact real change. "Every way in and out?" PJ barked, an unpleasant thought forming in his mind, the mild beginnings of anxiety. Malik nodded. "Name them," PJ said, certain that Marisa, albeit better at doors than her brother was, had overlooked something. Instead, frazzled by nerves, wanting this part to be over so he could relax against the door and read, Malik started naming his co-conspirators, figuring it wasn't snitching when getting discovered was part of the point. "No, sweetie, name the doors." Well, there was the gym. Joy had gotten further along in her speech than Malik, since there were few people paying enough attention to interrupt her. Omar and Amira were easily dispatching their opponents in the basketball tournament, setting up what everyone watching was hoping to see. 10 times if possible. A head-to-head encounter. Whoops and cheers emanated from the stands, drowning out Joy's reading, so the three people actually gathered around her, interested in her whole situation, could no longer hear the demands. Upstairs, Eli Mbele was feeling lucky to have been assigned the roof garden's exit to the back staircase. Not only was it a beautiful night with stars overhead and just enough of a breeze coming through the vents high up in the glass enclosure, but it was also the location of the movie marathon. All over the tennis courts and picnic tables, people huddled together, requesting more popcorn from the teachers who were fulfilling their roles as servers in good spirits. The movie currently playing was About Time, one of Eli's favorites, so he tried to read the speech in a considerate, quiet voice. Still, he was being shushed, and though he hated being shushed, and hated disrupting movies too, he believed in the cause and read on. Downstairs, chained to the secret basement entrance PJ was hoping had been forgotten, since it was supposed to be unknown to students, everyone knew about it, Lolo Dufree was taking a nap. She figured that people would be down there soon enough. They would open the unassuming, unmarked door by the library, thinking Marisa had forgotten about the exit, and they would rush down the steps 2 at a time, believing they were about to escape. But Marisa was smarter than everyone at school. And Lolo was sure that if Marissa's life had turned out differently, and she decided to hold hostages at gunpoint rather than at chainpoint, she would actually get the money, the plane to freedom, whatever she desired. In Lolo's lap, the 3 keys that corresponded to the padlocks hanging off her like menacing Christmas ornaments rested in a pool of melting butter. Soon, the butter would attract some nearby ants. Here was one now, already sniffing out the golden ambrosia and ready to report back to the colony. And Lolo would wish she had skipped the theatrics and just completed that step of the process, crowd or not. Back in the green room, PJ had granted Malik permission to finish reading. He was just about to reach the speech's climactic and climatic conclusion. Malik removed the keys from the tinfoil envelope at his side, each dripping with butter. His mouth went dry. He had hated this part of the plan all along and had tried to talk Marisa out of it. "People don't understand anything but melodrama," she'd said. "We need to put on a show." "Dear God, please tell me you're not about to do that," PJ said. Malik swallowed hard. If PJ directed the word "don't" at Malik, he might have to listen. This was PJ Singh, this year's host, partier-in-chief, the guy who basically ran the school with charm. Earlier that semester, PJ had come to the play Malik had acted in and personally delivered congratulatory flowers to every member in the cast. "I have to," Malik said. Then there was enough of a pause to serve as Malik's window. He examined the keys, small, sure, barely an inch long and thin, but still, in the end, keys. PJ said nothing. Mr. Giggs gasped. The freshman cried out in delight and disgust. Malik swallowed all three at once. Someone thought they had seen him chew, which for some reason felt particularly brutal. Eli took the keys one at a time, imagining they were popcorn kernels. Moments later, he realized he could ask for some actual popcorn from Master Declan, the head of the school, who was just now noticing Eli in his chains and furrowing his brow. Eli waved him over. Joy took hers with chugs of water, coughing them up several times before she finally felt their bumpy surface work their way down her throat. Marissa's words ran through her mind about melodrama, and Joy played up the cough to the best of her ability. People in her vicinity winced, then craned their necks so they wouldn't miss too much of the action happening on the court. Marissa, who had the largest crowd by far, held her keys up in the air for effect. Butter glinted in the white light shining over her head. She looked out at her audience, all these people who contributed to the sad state of coral reefs around the world, whether knowingly or not, whose home, however temporary it may be, was being destroyed by the gray-brown water of construction runoff. One of the last remaining spots where underwater beauty could be found was about to be wiped away, and none of them cared, none of them even knew. She made eye contact with every single person in front of her, not blinking the whole time, so they would know just how serious she was. In that prolonged eye contact alone, she won over at least three of her fellow students, who had barely ever thought about reefs before, much less cared whether or not they had deteriorated. They, plus two teachers who would silently root for Marissa throughout the whole ordeal, though their positions prevented them from cheering on her malfeasance, suddenly found themselves thinking, "I'm on her side." The sheer determination on her face won them over, and they each took an unconscious step toward her, as if wanting her to see their gesture of allegiance. This, in addition to the handful of others who were convinced by her words alone. Two more teachers, Miss Dooley, AP History, and Mr. Sanchez, Spanish, French, Postmodern Lit, took a step forward too, but they were thinking they would stop her. They, more than anyone else, save for Marissa herself, were getting a sense of where this was all headed, the headaches, inconveniences, and scandals to come. Two other students stepped forward as well. Both of them, Maya Clitizen and Michael Obonte, meaning to profess their sudden love for Marissa. They hadn't known until that moment when she held the keys up to the light that they loved her. But now it was so obvious to them it felt ridiculous to think of a time when they had not loved her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.